¿Qué está pasando, amigos? Welcome back. In this video, we're going to continue our discussion of for loops. Specifically, we're going to see how to use for loops to work with vectors in MATLAB. Remember, in a previous video, we talked about how to use the for loop syntax to work with scalar-valued variables. We're going to base our work in this video on that previous work together. Let's run through the syntax of a for loop. When we write a for loop in MATLAB, we type the word for, F-O-R, then we write a space. We then define a loop index, which is a variable we're going to reference inside the loop body. We set that loop index variable equal to a row vector of desired index values. This vector is going to include all the values we want the index to take inside of the loop itself. After we write that initial line, we push return, and then we type executable lines of code inside the body of the loop. We end the for loop by typing the word end, E-N-D, and that indicates to MATLAB that this is the complete for loop. For our first example, let's start with a 1x5 vector given here on screen. We're going to call that vector X, and that row vector is going to have the entries 10, 5, 0, negative 5, 10. We're going to use our for loop to actually cycle through each individual element and print those out on screen. Let's get started by actually defining that vector. We said that the vector started at 10, went down by negative 5, and went all the way down to negative 10. Before we write the rest of our for loop, let's go ahead and make sure we properly stored that vector, 10, 5, 0, negative 5, 10. We're going to use our for loop structure to run through the individual elements of that. To do so, let's go ahead and type for and then a space. Our index variable in this case we'll call k. And this index variable is going to start at 1 and go up to the length of this vector. Remember, the length of x is going to be the number of entries in x. So in this case, x has 5 entries. This vector 1 to the length of x is simply going to store a row vector of index values, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Remember, we said in a previous video that each entry has not only an encoded value, but also an address. That addressing scheme is how we're going to access the individual entry. Specifically, in the kth loop, let's access the kth entry of that vector. We are now done with this for loop, so we type end. Let's save this, clear the command window, and run it. We see that MATLAB did 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 iterations of the for loop, and in each iteration, it just worked through the individual elements of this vector. This example is not super clear because the output has no context. Let's go ahead and refine this example a little bit by adding some words to make it easier to see what MATLAB is doing. To do that, we'll use the fprintf command, and specifically, we're gonna write a string on the inside. That string is gonna read entry number percent %d. Remember, that means turn the index k into an integer inside this string. So entry number k of vector x is, and then we're going to print out the actual value stored in x sub k. So notice the k refers to the address, the x sub k refers to the individual element value stored at that index value. The other thing that we saw is that we can use the pause command to slow down the for loop and see each individual iteration of the loop. Finally, remember that the backslash n inside this string gets me down to the next line in my command window when fprintf produces the desired string in each iteration. Let's run this step by step. So when I push enter or run, MATLAB is going to first execute line 1, which is to store this vector in memory. Then it's going to drop into the for loop where it takes the index variable k and runs through the vector of values 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 is the length of this vector. And then it will run through the body of this loop individually. First, it will print out this line of code, which says what is the current value of the index, and also what is the stored value of the vector at that location, and then it will pause. Let's go ahead and run. It says entry number 1 of vector x is 10. That's exactly what we expect up here. MATLAB is currently paused at this location, waiting for me to tell it to move again. If I push enter or any key, MATLAB will update the index variable to go to the next value. In this case, the next value of this vector is 2. So it says entry number 2 value is 5. Entry number 3 value is 0. 4 is negative 5, and 5 is 10. MATLAB is at the pause command in the last iteration of this loop. When I push enter one more time, MATLAB does a quick check to see whether or not the index variable has run through all possible values in the row vector of desired values. In this case, it has, so we exit the loop, and that's the last line of the program, so the program stops. Notice in this situation, we've used MATLAB to run through the individual entries by the appropriate address inside that matrix. Now that we've seen how to access the individual elements of a vector, let's take a look at a second example where we use a for loop to copy one vector into another vector. To do this, let's go ahead and suppose that we have a vector x, which is the counting numbers from 1 to 8. Here we'll store x as a column vector using the transpose operator. Let's go ahead and check that this does what we want it to do. Notice what we're going to try to do is actually run through the individual elements of x to create a new vector y with the exact same values. To do this, let's go ahead and initialize my vector y to be zeros. The number of zeros that we're going to have is equal to the length of my vector. Notice that this vector x is a column vector, so suppose maybe we want y to also be a column vector. So we'll say the number of rows of y is going to be equal to the number of rows of x, and then we'll say that we want y to have one column. When I define this initial value for y, notice it's just an 8x1 vector of all zeros. Now that we have that, let's suppress it. Now that we have those two vectors stored, we're going to define a for loop. So we type for. We're going to define an index variable. I'm going to use I to run through the rows. This value of I is going to start at 1 and go down to the length of my vector x. In each iteration, I'm going to store in the ith row of y the value stored in the ith row of x. In other words, all I'm doing is copying the individual values of x into the individual values of y in the appropriate location. Let's go ahead and save this, clear our screen, and run it. Notice MATLAB did a lot of work very, very quickly. So in the first iteration of this for loop, MATLAB copied in location y1, 1, the value of x1, 1. Well, the value of x1, 1 was 1. In the next iteration, MATLAB copied the next location down. And we moved all the way down until the end of that vector, where now we have an identical copy of y, each of whose elements is exactly the same as the values of x. Notice in MATLAB, we could have done the same thing by storing the vector z equal to x. This command creates a vector z whose individual elements are equal to x. In other words, these are two different ways to accomplish the same goal. One notable variation of this example is we could turn this column vector into a row vector. So instead of defining y as a column vector, we could swap the rows and the columns. So in other words, this is going to be a 1x8. And then for each individual entry in my vector, instead of storing the ith entry in the ith row, we could store the ith entry of x in the ith column. Let's go ahead and run this step by step. As we do so, each time we're going to copy the next element of x into the next column of y. And that means at the end of my for loop, I have a copy of x as appropriate. Notice, of course, we do not have to use the pause button. This is a debugging code where we can check each step functions appropriately. If instead I were to suppress this output, clear my memory, clear my screen, and rerun this code, notice at the end of this, I have my vector x and I have my vector y, and thus the output that I desired. Let's take a look at yet a third example application of where we can use for loops to process vectors. Suppose that we wanted to create the sum of two vectors. We'll talk more about this when we start talking about vector and matrix operations. But assuming that x is an n x1 column vector and y is an n x1 column vector, we could add x plus y simply by adding the individual elements and storing the sum in the appropriate address. In other words, x1 plus y1 and the sum of those two scalars get stored in position 1. x2 plus y2, the sum of those two scalars gets stored into position 2. And we continue all the way down to the end of our vector until we sum the last two elements, xn plus yn, the sum is stored in position n of our new vector. Claim, this is a perfect opportunity to use for loops because we are doing repeated addition inside a vector. To do this, we're going to go ahead and store two vectors, x and y. X, we're going to do something special. We're going to define x as a vector having all twos in it. So we'll say two times ones. And this will be perhaps, let's call it an 8x1. Let's go ahead and run that code over in the command window so we can see what this produces. Then we're going to do something special and actually produce powers of two. Remember, we had this concept of element-wise powers using the dot caret operator. This operator allows me to take powers of each individual entry as long as the powers in the exponent are stored in the same dimensions of the power of the base. So in this case, suppose that I wanted to take 2 to the first, 2 to the second, all the way down to 2 to the eighth. In that case, I'm going to put a column vector with 8 components into the exponent. And what this is going to do is take the base. Here, the vector in the base is all twos. Let's go ahead and put that right next to the vector in the exponent, which is a 1x8 column vector, just like we saw. And then I'll go ahead and end this. So notice what this line of code does is it takes the base 2 and raises it to the first power. Notice that it gets value 2. Takes the base 2 and raises it to the second power. That gets value 4. Takes the base 2 and raises it to the third power. That gets value 8. Base 2, raise it to the fourth power, that gets value 16, and it goes all the way down to the end of this until it raises 2 to the eighth power, which is indeed 256. So in other words, if I were to take this line of code, we'll go ahead and run it one more time and set x equal to that, I would get the first 8 powers of 2 starting at 1 going up to 8. We'll store that as the vector x that we're going to use in this code. For y, we're going to store y as negative 1 times 1s, and this is also going to be an 8x1 vector. Let's go ahead and check that this works. So here we've got negative 1 times 1. And then notice if I add x plus y, basically I take all of these powers of 2 and I subtract 1 from them, giving 2 to the n minus 1, where n starts at 1 and goes up to 7. This is a very, very famous sequence of numbers that is related to the Tower of Hanoi. We don't have to talk a lot about that. The point is that in this particular for loop, we're going to add these two vectors together. After we define those two vectors, we're going to initialize a vector s, which is for the sum, and that's going to store all zeros before we actually enter the for loop. In this case, the length of this vector should be equal to the length of the vectors that we're trying to add. So let's call it x, number of rows, and one column. Now we're going to enter our for loop. So we're going to use the syntax for. In this case, we're going to run through the rows of these vectors, so we'll use row index I, and that starts at the value of 1 and goes to the length of the vector that we have. Of course, we should check that x and y has the same length, but that's a little bit more advanced than what we're doing in this introductory tutorial. Later, we'll actually combine for statements with if statements so that we can do some error checking when we write our code. In any case, we're going to run from the index variable of 1 all the way through the length of x. And then in each iteration, we're going to say that the next entry of my sum vector is going to get the sum of the current entries of my two vectors that I'm trying to sum. So in other words, the ith entry of the s vector is going to be the ith entry of the x vector plus the ith entry of the j vector. Once I'm done with this, I can go ahead and end that. And for the purposes of this particular demonstration, let's go ahead and suppress this output to begin with. We'll save this demonstration and then clear over here and run our code. Notice at the end of this for loop, s is actually the sum of x plus y. And we can check that by actually just adding x plus y. In other words, we've just created code that took the vector x, added it to the vector y, element by element, using our for loop. Let's take a look at our most complex example so far, which is to swap the individual elements of a vector into different positions. Let's suppose that we have a 6x1 column vector. In this case, we'll define the individual entries to be the counting numbers 1 to 6. Let's imagine that we wanted to create a new vector y where we're actually permuting or swapping the values of x into different locations. So the first entry of y is the fifth entry of x. In this case, that value has 5. The second entry of y is the fourth entry of x. For this example, that value would be 4. And so on. The claim that we're going to make is that we can use the for loop structure to be able to define vectors like this. To do so, let's define our matrix X, which is a 6x1 vector. This is going to be 1, 2, 6, but we're going to take the transpose of that. Let's test that that line of code actually produces what I want. To do that, I copy and paste, and we notice that X is a 6x1 whose first value is 1 and goes all the way to 6, just like this example requires. We'll go ahead and suppress that output. The next thing we're going to do is define the vector of swaps we want to make. So we'll call this vector swap, and then we'll store the entry by entry swaps we want to make. So notice the first thing we want to do is we want to store the fifth entry of x in the first entry of y. So we'll say 5 is going to go in position 1, entry 4 is going to go into position 2, entry 2 is going to go into position 3, entry 6 is going to go in position 4, entry 1 is in position 5, and finally entry 3 is in position 6. Let's grab that vector and confirm that indeed we have defined the swaps that we want. The last thing we're going to do before we pop into our for loop is to initialize the y vector to be a 6x1 vector of all zeros. To do that, I'm going to say that y has the same number of rows as x does, and it is a single column vector. Notice when I run this line of code, I'm going to initialize y as zeros. Let's go ahead and suppress that line. Now what we're going to do is run through a for loop. So we say for space index variable I. This is going to run from 1 all the way up to the length of my original vector x. In each situation, I'm going to set the next entry in I equal to x of the stored value in the swap command. So let's think about this for a moment. In the first iteration, we're going to say that y1 is equal to x of swap 1. Well, swap 1, the value stored in the first entry of swap is 5, so y1 is equal to x of 5. When we go down to our next iteration, y2 is going to be equal to x of swap 2. Swap 2 stores the value of 4, so y2 is equal to x of 4. That's exactly what we wanted. This will run through step by step until we've populated y with all of the corresponding values of x. Let's go ahead and suppress that line and then run this code. Notice if I type y, we have now swapped the corresponding values of x with the desired permutation that we wanted. Indeed, if we print out x right next to a column y, notice that the fifth value of x ends up in the first entry of y, which is what we saw here. The fourth value of x ends up in the second entry of y, and we move all the way down to the bottom. With that, we'll go ahead and end the tutorial portion of this video where we've introduced how to use for loops in order to access individual vector entries and to play with those entries and manipulate those. We are going to expand on this later in this course. In fact, one of the deliverables that I'm going to ask of each of you is actually to write your own matrix functions using some of the functionality that we've seen in these for loops. This is a super fundamental idea in matrix computation and actually underlies at a very foundational level many of the things that are happening in matrix algebra. That leads us to the community challenge for this video, which is to, in the comment section of this video, please post interesting examples of how to use for loops in vector analysis. As always, I welcome your questions and comments also in that comment section, and I look forward to serving you in the next video.